Good morning.
Morning.
You guys all right?
Yeah.
Good to be here again. Absolutely. Have been amazed by God's grace throughout the service so far. Love the video that we just watched about making disciples. That's our mission as believers. And making disciples takes place, not just here, through one man, preaching God's word, that's part of it. But you're all disciples. You're called to go out and make disciples wherever God has placed you. And we do that through the proclamation of God's word, and we do that through prayer. Because we realize that God is the one that brings about change and growth in people's lives. And so, you guys should be in Samuel chapter, 1 Samuel chapter. I always have to be careful when I say Samuel. I used to say it really weird. I don't know if it's because of the hybrid between my British and American accent, it gets weird. So 1 Samuel 24, you should be there. And I'm not going to read it because we've just read it. But what I'm going to do is just give you guys a recap on what's going on. As you guys are aware, David, the whole thing, the whole theme and what this is all about is David sparing Saul's life. And so Saul is after David, and David ends up in a cave, and not long after, Saul ends up in that same cave, not knowing that David is there. And David has an opportunity to take Saul's life and bring about the end of his struggles with Saul, but he decides not to. And that is an amazing story of mercy. And so that's what we're going to be focusing on this morning. Pray with me, and we'll get into our teaching for this morning. Father, thank you so much that in and through your word, you have helped us not only know how to live a life of obedience to you, but Father, you've given us true understanding of who you are. And so Father, as we look at the story and look at your word, Father, this story is not, it's real, it happened, and Father, as we look at it, may you help us see the many lessons that are in here, and may it, through your word, empower us to live how you've called us to live, anchored in who Jesus is and what he's done for us. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen. In the year 1502, a church in Italy hired an artist to fashion a giant piece of marble into a work of art. Not long after he had begun the work of crafting this piece of marble, this artist made a mistake that left a hole in the bottom of this incredible piece of marble. Assuming it was beyond repair, the church covered it up for over 20 years, and a certain man eventually heard about the piece and how it had been destroyed. He sought to find the stone, and when he did, he declared he could redeem it. After many hours of work, he transformed what was once lost and broken into one of the greatest statues ever made. The statue was of King David, and the artist was, of course, Michelangelo. This story has always been intriguing to me because in so many ways it resembles the story of David himself. This period of David's life resembles the marble rock in Italy before Michelangelo discovered it, because at the moment, David's life seems to be covered, lost, and broken. The previous episode from the life of David revealed to us that he was at the top of Israel's most wanted list. He was a fugitive on the run. He was public enemy number one. And this was not because he was a man convicted of felony or treason or an unlawful act. No, the reason why David was on the run and he was a fugitive was because he had become a threat to Saul. You see, David, in the eyes of the people, had become a conquering hero, and so therefore he was favored by the people. And so David's achievements had become a threat to King Saul, And because of this, at the top of his list of to-dos as king was to capture and destroy David. In view of this, here's the question that comes to the surface. Why does David have to endure this season of hostility when God can easily deliver him and bring it all about in an end? Why does David have to endure this difficult season of his life and often communicate his frustration with these words? How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all the day? At some point in our lives, we've all asked the same question. We have. How long, O Lord? How long do I have to endure in this difficult marriage? How long do I have to live with all of these health issues? How long, O Lord, do I have to carry the burden of this financial hardship? Because if God's ultimate purpose involves peace, if his ultimate purpose involves joy and no more tears, then why is this journey so hard? Why doesn't God remove all obstacles and difficulties and make our lives easy? This is why. It's in the dark caves of life that some of the most transformative moments in our lives take place. These caves are blessings in disguise. It's where God does some of his best work in us. We want everything to be quick and easy, but God is not in the business of catering for our convenience. He's concerned with something more important than our convenience. Our gracious and great God is concerned about crafting our character. Just like David, you may be in a difficult season of your life and you may feel forgotten and left behind. Through God's word, I am here to remind you that God has not forgotten you. He's still actively at work in your life. He's a good God. He hears you. He cares. And scripture reminds us over and over again that he is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. In our passage for this morning, that is 1 Samuel 24, David has at his fingertips the opportunity to take matters into his own hands and usher in the easy life. But the decision he makes is unexpected. And the decision he makes consists of powerful lessons we can learn and apply. But the most important truth we can learn from David's decision and actions is that they are spirit-empowered. And the author who composed this story intends for us to see a vivid contrast between Saul and David. Saul represents a life without God's Spirit, but David represents a life with God's Spirit. So this morning, this is what we're going to do. We're going to use the life of David to help us discover how the Holy Spirit crafts our character in difficult seasons. Firstly, the Spirit of God crafts your character in difficult seasons of life when he enables you to discern God's will. He enables you to discern God's will. Saul has been in hot pursuit of David for a while now. He's not alone. It tells us that he's accompanied by 3,000 men. We're told in verse 2 that these men are chosen men. These are men specifically chosen and trained for this mission. These are men handpicked for the express purpose of capturing and destroying David. And And after many hours trekking through valleys and hiking up hills and mountains in search of David, Saul and his army arrived at a cave that presents to them an occasion for rest and refreshment. What we do know is that Saul enters this cave alone and enters it in order to attend to his needs, to relieve himself. We don't know exactly what he does in there, it doesn't tell us, but I can imagine that after a long day in the wild chasing an enemy, let's just say he used the restroom. Let's just say that after using the restroom that he took a nap. But this is what's interesting. Saul does this carelessly. He seems to have overlooked the protocol that involves sending some of his men in the cave in order to make sure that it's safe. He is careless, and his carelessness could cost his life. Because at this point, Saul unknowingly falls into the hands of David, because David and his men were already situated in the innermost part of the cave, the end of verse 3 tells us. And they were possibly resting and hiding from Saul. So Saul is unaware of this. He's totally oblivious to the fact that he has just placed himself completely at David's mercy. Now, David has the opportunity, like we often do, to easily rid himself of an enemy and all the heartache related. Think about it. If David takes the opportunity and hacks Saul to death, he will no longer be on the run, constantly fearing for his life, but he will instantly be crowned king, and the fear and anxiety he's been living with will ultimately disappear. And if he killed Saul, he wouldn't be killing a good king, right? He would be killing a bad king who in God's eyes is no longer fit to be king anyway. So David, right now, has at his fingertips the opportunity to speed up the process and to bring about what God has already promised. Now it tells us that David wasn't alone, his men were with him. And what did they think of all of this? What advice did they give to David? Look at what they say in the first part of verse 4. It says, "And the men of David said to him, 'Here is the day of which the Lord said to you, behold, I'll give your enemy into your hand, and you shall do to him as it shall seem good to you.'" David's men see this opportunity as a hand of God and as a way in which God is finally providing for their deliverance from all of this running and hiding. So they do all that they can to persuade David to end Saul's life. And this opportunity favors David. Plus, like we've heard, his men are in full agreement. Question: what would you do in this situation? Someone just said, "I'll kill him." How would you respond? Most important question we need to look at now is, how did David respond? It seems that this all makes sense to David. It seems that his men have persuaded him, because what he does next is that he quietly arms himself with his sword, discreetly makes his way to Saul, possibly in order to kill him. But at the last moment, just when he was about to put Saul to death, he stops. He doesn't strike Saul, but instead, it says in the last part of verse 4, he stealthily cuts off a corner of Saul's robe. Interesting. Very unexpected. David then returns to his men. They're expecting his sword, his clothes, his hands to be covered in blood, but it's not. Instead, he's carrying a snippet or an extract of Saul's royal robe. So they possibly ask him, David, what's happening? Why are you carrying this piece of royal robe? It looks amazing and everything, but where's all the blood? Have you just had a shower? I mean, like, what's going on? Verse 6 tells us David's response to them. David said to his men, "The Lord forbid that I should do this thing to my Lord, the Lord's anointed, to put out my hand against him, seeing he is the Lord's anointed." David's response to his men is profound, and this is what it teaches us. This is what it teaches us. What may seem totally justified in the eyes of others may not be justified in the eyes of God. David knew it would be wrong to take Saul's life, because if God had allowed Saul to reign in the first place, then God would be the one to remove him. In other words, despite the promise from God that David would be king, despite peer pressure from his men and the convenience of the circumstance, David refused to try to bring about God's will in his own way. We may have a good goal in mind, perhaps a sense that God has promised us something, but we must remember that it's wrong to bring about a good thing in the wrong way. How are you trying to bring about God's will in your own way? God's will is that you are saved through faith in Christ alone. How are you trying to achieve salvation in your own way? Perhaps it's through regular church attendance, daily Bible reading, or prayer, or giving financially, or serving. Are you trying to achieve salvation through your good works? If you are, you are trying to achieve a good thing in the wrong way. God's will is that men work hard in order to provide for their families. How are you trying to achieve this good thing in the wrong way? Perhaps it's by neglecting your family. When quality time with your family becomes non-existent because you're consumed with work, you're probably trying to achieve a good thing in the wrong way. And this one's for the singles out here. Singles, so many single guys, girls here, awesome. And you guys want to get married, and that is a good thing. My question is, how are you trying to bring about something that is good, something that is great in God's own way? For some of you, it might be through missional dating. Missional dating is basically a Christian dating someone who's not a Christian in order so that they might get saved through the relationship. That's just an example. How are you trying to bring about God's will in your life in the wrong way? We're just so prone to this, aren't we? We're so prone to bringing about God's will in the wrong way. And this is why you and I should be so thankful for the Holy Spirit. Because what the Spirit does is He enables us not only to discern what God's will is, but He also enables us to discern the way in which His will is supposed to be accomplished. And this is the first way God crafts our character. He enables us to discern His will and His ways. The second way in which God crafts our character in difficult seasons is that He creates in us a tender heart. After David's encounter with Saul, we're told in verse 5 that his heart struck him. And the reason why is because he had cut off a corner of Saul's robe. Now, this is interesting. David is troubled by this. And he shouldn't be troubled by this, because he seems to have just extended mercy to his enemy. But yet, his heart has struck him, and he's troubled by this. And why is he troubled by this? It's because the robe was a symbol of Saul's royal authority, and David felt bad that that he had done anything against Saul's God-appointed authority. And in addition to this, the most important thing we can learn from how David felt is the incredible work God's Spirit does in our hearts. God's Spirit gives us a tender heart. And the tender heart that is sensitive to him is a mark of true character. Is your heart tender? Are you sensitive to God's work through his Spirit? If you are, you will be troubled not by the obvious big sins, right, that we have and we act out, but you will be troubled by every motive, by every thought, word, and action that is classified as sin in the eyes of our holy God. You will be troubled by your constant irritation and snappiness towards your family. If your heart is tender, you will be troubled by your lack of discipline or poor stewardship of your time. If your heart is tender and sensitive, you will be troubled by your lack of desire for the salvation or the lot of the lost. And if your heart is truly tender, you'll be troubled by your deadness and lack of remorse over the sins that once troubled you. Is your heart tender? Are you sensitive to God's work in your life through his Spirit? Because if you are, you'll be troubled not just by the obvious big sins, but you'll be troubled by every thought, motive, word, and action that is classified as sin in the eyes of our holy God. The Spirit not only enables you to discern God's will and creates in you a tender heart, the third way God crafts our character by his Spirit is that he produces right actions in our life. He produces right actions in our life. So far in this story, Saul has just escaped death, and this is because David is moved by the Spirit to act in a way that is contrary to popular opinion and his own sinful desires. And so this is what's happening now. So after attending his needs, Saul does this. He exits the cave. And then we're told in verse 8 that David and his men also exit the cave soon afterwards. And as Saul and his army get about a stone's throw away from the cave, they suddenly hear the following shout from the cave: "My Lord the King!" Saul turns and looks towards the cave. Can't see all that clearly, but he witnesses a man bowed with his face to the ground, paying homage to him. And this is what I want you guys to notice in this situation. David's actions here are risky, because what he's just done is that he's exposed himself to the man who has assembled an entire army with the express purpose of capturing and destroying him right now. If Saul decides to attack David, there is no way David will escape 3,000 men, handpicked and chosen with the purpose of killing him. It's risky, and it's as risky as if we were to run into a den of lions and just lock the doors behind us and just see what happens, right? It's as risky as us knowing that a particular location or an alley is gang infested or something, and we just go down there at night. David's actions are risky because his life is at risk. But he's compelled to do so. Not for the adrenaline, but in order to make an appeal to Saul. And here is what I want you to see. Though the work of God's Spirit begins with conviction and restraint, it doesn't end there. It always turns into behavior. It's not enough to just admit the convicting work of the Spirit in our lives. The Spirit's work should move us from conviction to action. The Holy Spirit convicts us, leads us to truth, and then empowers us to obey that truth. The Spirit always does His work, but million-dollar question is, will you respond? It's been said that the great measure of your nearness to God is the length of time between conviction and repentance. David was struck to the heart, and then what does he do? He reacts. He's not only restrained from an awful decision, he takes steps in the right direction. The Spirit does not only prevent us from doing what we shouldn't do, He compels us to do what we should do. Question. Right now, what is God, through His Spirit, asking of you? Maybe you need to take steps towards making peace with someone you're in conflict with. Maybe you need to confess sin. I heard this incredible quote today. It said, "Hidden sin will kill your soul. Confessed sin will heal your soul." Do you need to confess something, both to God and the people God has placed around you? Maybe you need to ask someone for forgiveness. Maybe you might have made a snide remark or said or did something that at the moment didn't quite sit right with you, but you sort of are going on with your day and just forgetting about it, and there's something in you that keeps reminding you that what you just did wasn't right. You may need to ask for forgiveness. Or maybe you need to stop trying to gain God's love through works and accept His love for you, freely given to you in Christ. God's word, the Bible, reveals to us how we're to live, but God has not only given us His word for us to know, He's given us His word for us to follow. Don't just agree with the Bible intellectually, but also apply it to your life practically. If you're filled with the Spirit, conviction must turn to action. Pray that God moves you to action, and don't delay. Don't delay. The Spirit not only crafts our character by enabling us to discern God's will and creating in us a tender heart and producing right actions in our life. Lastly, in the difficult seasons of life, God's Spirit crafts your character by transforming your affections. David was pressed by his men to take Saul's life, but he resists. He then moves to action by coming out of the cave in order to expose himself to his enemy. He calls out to Saul, and as soon as he has Saul's attention, he speaks these words that reveal to us that his affections have changed towards Saul. Listen to what David says in verses 10 and 11. It says, "Behold, this day your eyes have seen how the Lord gave you today into my hand in the cave. And some told me to kill you, but I spared you. I said, I will not put out my hand against my Lord, for he is the Lord's anointed." Verse 11, "See, my father, see the corner of your robe in my hand, for by the fact that I cut off the corner of your robe and did not kill you, you may know and see that there is no wrong or treason in my hand, and I have not sinned against you, though you hunt my life to take it." Notice David's affections have changed. He was on the brink of maybe taking Saul's life. Now David is expressing respect and love for him. David did not only appeal to Saul's honor by paying homage to him, but also to his affections. And this is so clear because he even calls Saul father. And this is because David had married Saul's daughter, right? So Saul was his father-in-law. And the reason David said what he said was because of his desire to bring to an end this family feud. David's desires have changed. He now desires reconciliation. Where did this come from? Why did he take such a risk? Let me remind you that right now, David's encounter with Saul is risky because David is outnumbered, outgunned, and outmatched, and yet he risks everything. And he risks everything in order to see a broken man saved, because the only way this bloodthirsty enemy was going to change and be saved was not through aggression and the fight, but the only way Saul was to change was if he was made aware of the mercy he had just received. This is exactly why David steps out of the cave and unveils to Saul an extract of his royal robe. In doing this, this is what David is saying. Saul had an opportunity to end your life. I had an opportunity to be delivered and be relieved from the stress and the fear and the anxiety and the pain you've caused me, but Saul, I chose to extend mercy to you. Mercy is such a powerful virtue. Its power knows no end. Mercy is powerful enough to soften the heart of the most ruthless individual. And Saul, after being made aware of the mercy shown to him by David, becomes impacted by it in a way that is totally unexpected. Listen to his response in verses 16 to 19. Saul says, it says, as soon as David had finished speaking these words to Saul, Saul said, "Is this your voice, my son David?" And Saul lifted up his voice and wept. He said to David, "You are more righteous than I, for you have repaid me good, whereas I have repaid you evil. And you have declared this day how you have dealt well with me, in that you did not kill me when the Lord put me into your hands. For if a man finds his enemy, will he let him go away saved? So may the Lord reward you with good for what you have done to me this day." A knife to the throat didn't draw out this warm confession from Saul. But this confession came as a result of a word and an act of mercy. When an enemy sees mercy, when you are merciful to someone who has hurt you or hates you, it can have a life-changing effect on them. David's ultimate motivation for this unexpected act of mercy was that he knew that he too was a broken man who needed mercy. If you feel as though you are above others, you will never extend mercy. We need mercy. All of us need mercy. We really do. So how does this come about for us? How does the Spirit reshape our affections? This is how. Just as David appeals to the piece of Saul's robe as a symbol of mercy, the ultimate proof of mercy is shown to us in David's greater son, Jesus Christ. The cross is the evidence of God's grace and mercy that brings about healing to our souls. When we are aware of our brokenness and sinfulness, we say to Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. By seeing the mercy and grace shown to us by the Son of David, Jesus Christ, this moves us beyond people's opinions. It humbles us, but it also emboldens us to risk love. Why? Because we understand that if God can change us, God can change others as well. If you are here, you are a believer, you are a recipient of God's everlasting mercy. You are God's enemy, but He had mercy on you by sending His one and only Son to die on your behalf and conquer death by resurrecting on the third day. And in Christ, right now, if you're a believer, in Christ, God is not giving you what you deserve. He's not. You deserve eternal punishment. But because of what Jesus did, God's not giving you what you deserve, but He is giving you what you do not deserve. And that is eternal life. Understand this. If you're here and if you're a Christian, all you'll ever know from now on throughout eternity is God's mercy and grace. We may be in the dark caves of difficulties, yet within we're being shaped and inspired by mercy and grace. When Saul saw mercy from David, he said to David in verse 20, this is what Saul said to David in verse 20, look at it, he says, now I know that you are truly the king. In the same way, when we look at the mercy of Jesus shown to us on Calvary, we, in a similar way, bow our knees in surrender to Jesus and say, yes, Jesus, now I know that you are truly the King of Kings. Amen. Have you said that? Have you confessed Jesus as the King of your life? To have Jesus as King means to yield to His Spirit. This doesn't make following Jesus easy, but it makes following Jesus worth it. It may be a long and difficult journey, but God is crafting you, shaping you into something glorious. Will you invite Him to do so? Will you allow Him to do so? Do not resist the work of the Spirit in your life, no matter what season you find yourself in. May you be inspired and empowered to express mercy to others as you look at God's mercy towards you in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Pray with me. Jesus, you are the solid rock. In you we stand. Father, may you do in our hearts what I could never do with this sermon. In your name, in your Son's name we pray. Amen.